Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to this morning's study. And we're going to continue our snail's pace study of Daniel chapter 11. We'll see what happens today, if we can pull some of these things together. But before we begin, can you join me in a word of prayer? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for everything that you do in our lives. And thankful for the time that we have to study and the things that you have taught us. And we just pray, Lord, for your spirit to be here as we open your word together, and that you can unite our hearts in Christian love, help us to show Christ's character and love to those around us. I'm thankful that it's warmer here and that my vehicle runs. And I know that many people have things they are thankful for. And there's many things upon our hearts as well, things that we worry about, and things we have no control over. We leave those things in your hands, and we ask, Lord, that the truths that we understand can encourage us and give us faith and confidence in your leading and your providences. Please be with us now. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning again, and nice to see everyone here. I mean, we definitely have a bit lower attendance over this tedious study of Daniel chapter 11, and less views. And I don't think it's because necessarily less people are watching the videos, but people are not watching as many of the videos individually is probably my guess. I mean, there might be some people who dropped off and just said, well, This is too much for me. We do have good view of the three angels' messages of righteousness by faith videos. And we do have a lot of people who have watched the symbolic use of numbers video from Sabbath. So that new series. So that's good. So I'm thankful for that. I'd like to think that what I'm doing is helpful to people who are studying, and that they receive a blessing from it. You know, obviously, there's lots of other people who are studying God's word individually and trying to understand some of the same things we're trying to understand. So I have watched other people's videos, people who are, you know, somewhat connected with this movement, at least some of the people who have, you know, the charts and behind them. There are some quite different views. There are some people who they really stick closely to Uriah Smith, that Uriah Smith is the bee's knees when it comes to understanding Daniel chapter 11. There's some who have modified views of things. And I guess we would be a group that has some details that would differ for the most part from what we've inherited in understanding Daniel chapter 11. But we find overall that this is correct. And I think the main innovation that we have here in Daniel 11, just in the historical understanding, is that we see God's hand in providence in these things. So we see Christ where other people are looking at things addressing, you know, Roman history. And so that difference, I think, is to me, it's very interesting that idea showed up in what we're studying. So where we're having the problem right now is we're taking what Jeff had given us, that is the idea is that Julius Caesar is going to be typical of Bush the second, and that Augustus Caesar is going to be typical of Obama, and Tiberius Caesar is typical of Trump. Now, and I really want to look at this and try to understand how this can fit in with this historical application. Because definitely when we look at something like, well, Obama's taxes, and Trump being a vile person, right? We can definitely see a fit. Now, as far as Bush II, the problem with the Julius Caesar parallel, And we have struggled either making this Julius Caesar being a symbol of the papacy or the papacy along with Bush II. And now we're exploring the idea that it's just Bush II, the Jewish Julius Caesar, in that he's typifying George W. Bush, right? So we start that way back in verse 16, and we're going to say, well, here's Julius Caesar, and now we're going to say that he's Bush the second. So we have this transition. I guess that's verse 17. Is that 17 or is that 16? Let me see here. Yeah, that's 17. Okay. So we're going to have this transition from George Bush the first, and we're not really addressing Clinton. He's not really mentioned here. We have this transition, and this transition is dealing with this war. And specifically, we have a count of days that comes from H3615 that marks 9 years and 327 days from the end of the Gulf War, which is under Bush's the first administration, to Bush the second's inauguration on January 20th, 2001. So that brings us to looking at Julius Caesar then as being Bush the second. So that's where we kind of addressed yesterday. So we got to this idea that we're now just saying that Julius Caesar is representing Bush the second. So him turning his face toward the fort of his own land. We say that USA is the armies of Rome, right? So you got this, and this some of this stuff we might revise. So the idea is his own land is Rome, but we would probably have to then say, well, maybe it's the USA. And the USA being the promised land makes more sense. So here it's going to be Rome, right? But here this is going to be the USA, not the papacy. So what his own land is Rome. We're saying, well, Rome represents the papacy. But here it's the USA. It's the armies of Rome. So in that way, it's connected to the symbol of Rome. Okay. But he shall stumble and fall and not be found. Now, we looked at this not be found, and we found that this refers to a death of a person. Right, so there's other places where it applies to somebody dying, and usually the wicked, right? So he dies and he's going to not be found. Okay, so that this applies to Caesar's assassination on March 15th, 44 BC, I think is interesting. Now, what we don't have is we don't have what that would parallel in the history of George Bush. So George W. Bush, he's going to run 2 terms. But does he stumble and fall, and is he not and not be found, right? So any thoughts on this? I know, Stephen, do you have any thoughts about this and what we could do with the death of Caesar? I did watch a video that went through his assassination, the 21 or 28 stab wounds, and then what happened at his funeral, the riots, and what happened afterwards, his will, and how Octavius, his nephew, is then going to be the heir and have his name to change to Gaius Julius Caesar. So he becomes Caesar. So he has the same name as Julius Caesar. Interesting stuff that I never knew. And then how they end up with all of the conspirators are all eventually killed. 60 of them, and then you're going to have the second triumvirate, and then and I'm just getting into the part where Augustus becomes the emperor. So I'm just getting into that history. So when we look at Obama compared to Bush the second, there's obviously not the death of George Bush the second. So how do we address this? How would we take what happens to Julius Caesar and his assassination? Is there any parallel that we can take and apply to Bush the second? Any thoughts on that?
There's nothing that seems to stand out. All this, the fish's life that I can connect with that.
Okay. So you're saying there isn't anything, or there is?
Nothing comes to mind.
Yeah. So I can't think of it, right? So initially, we're kind of looking at this as the papacy, and it would be like sort of, the papacy conquers the United States. And see, and this is, we have connected this, obviously, Bush the second, it's in the time of 9/11, right? So I've looked at different things, trying to tie some of these numbers. Can I tie them to 9/11? What spans of time do I get? I looked at, the 3808 plus the 4672, and that's 8,480, I believe it is. And I tried to figure out where that would go. Let's see if I even have those saved. Sometimes I end up not saving them. And then, so anyway, I then looked at things like, so we got, what is it? So if we go from 9/11, so this is just something that's interesting, and we go to, and we, and we go to the inauguration of Obama. So this is, Obama's going to be typifying, Augustus, or Augustus is typifying Obama. And if we count from 9/11 to the inauguration of Obama, it's going to be 2,688 days. So that ends up being an interesting number. Right? So 2,688, that's 168 times 16. And we know that that's the number of days from November 24th, 2022, to April 5th, 2030. So I thought that was an interesting number, but I don't know if that's, a major issue, right? If that's something that, because there could be just coincidences of numbers that just show up like that that don't have any significance. But it seems kind of significant that we can take that number we already had. That's the application for the additional extension of time to file your taxes, the U.S. tax form 2688. And that we can count from 9/11 in 2001 to January 20th, 2009. So we kind of finished off with that. Would we say that that's significant? That somehow that deals, of course, with Augustus. It doesn't deal with, which is Obama. It doesn't particularly address George Bush the second, though he is the president in 2001. When 9/11 occurs. So how would we think about this? So I'm going to make a note of it here. So I have it. Sometimes I forget to add these notes. Now, we don't have a number 2688 anywhere here, right? We do have a 2388, which is 300 different. But I'm just going to put it when we get Obama and his and in his let me see here. There shall stand up in his state a raiser of taxes. And then I'm just going to put the footnote here. So, so any thoughts on this? Any comments? I know, I believe you guys have been studying this out, trying to make sense out of it all. Anybody? Just talk if you can. I should put US tax form.
Yeah, it's just interesting that it does seem to parallel. I was just looking at the days in between them two periods. Well, that would be like a sandwich between the 2688s. And it's 5056 days between them. And so I was just sort of seeing if there's anything there with maybe
Okay, so
just
505.
Five zero five six days between, so that would be between the 20th of January 2009 and the 24th of November 2022.
Okay. Okay. Makes sense.
So
Yeah, That's interesting. Okay, so 5 5 0 5 6, and now I knew that that number looked interesting. That looked familiar. The 5 0 5 6. So if we took that as a Hebrew number, it just refers to a horn, right? Sometimes translated as push. And it relates to, and the one that I'm more familiar with is 5 0 5 5. So 5 0 5 5 is the one that we have in Daniel chapter 11 verse 40, right? So I mean, you could say the number of days between, that is the exclusive count, is 5 0 5 5, but even 5 0 5 6 refers to a horn and the idea of pushing with a horn. And actually in the Hebrew, I mean, they're exactly the same, except that there's one is nagach and the other one is nagach. The only difference is one has two gimels. It has a dotted gimel, so it's nun gimel and chet, right? So those are the letters. That's how it's spelled. N-G, ch sound, ch sound. So they're really kind of the same word. Now, so what would be the significance then if you have is 2,688 days, and then from Obama's inauguration to this November 24th, 2022, you have this number of days, which is the Hebrew number to push, right? A horn, pushing with a horn. What would be the significance of that symbolically if we were going to take that as significant? What is it about Daniel 11, verse 40 that we could tie into this history?
Well, maybe you could relate to Obama being like the king of the south there, pushing against the king of the north.
Okay.
But then so, that only covers part of that time. So you have also Trump being part of that time. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay, so what you're saying is that so we have Republicans against Democrats, right? And so we're going though from Bush's time, right? When his time ends and Obama's time begins, and then we're going to be in this time of Biden, right? And then we have this extension all the way to April 5th, 2030. Right. So I'm just putting this in here, November 24th, 2022 to April 5th, 2030. Can't do a whole study on that, but at least just people can reference that, figure out what that is about. Okay. So we have that number. So that's something that we noted. So I looked at a lot of these different, these different numbers, right? So you got, you know, and I added some of them together, like stumble and fall. I thought, well, those might go together. Could I put them as a number? So those are going to be 9089 if you add them together, right? I looked at, you know, turning his face towards the fort of his own land. I mean, the 776 we attached to November 9th, 1989 to December 25th, 1991 as a symbol. And we know that that's going to be connected with that history of the time of the end in 1989, right? So there's a bunch of things there that would address this idea that this is the United States, right? Because the United States is going to be there as the King of the North. Right. So that's why we say the USA is the armies of Rome, because that's how we looked at November 9th, 1989. But that's going to be under Bush the First. So now, if we take, Bush II turning his face toward the fort of his own land, and that's Julius Caesar history, what is Bush II doing? And what we said is there is in that history under his dad this unfinished business, right? That's going to deal with the war in Iraq. Right. So we looked a little bit at that. So the war in Iraq is going to start in 2003. And I have two different dates. One is March 19th, and the other one is March 20th, 2003. So there's these two different dates given. And the war in Iraq is going to end, is it November 15th, 2011? So obviously it extends past the time that December. So I have if I just type it in, they say March 20th, 2003 to December 15th, 2011. So some people give March 19th. If we look at those dates, so March 19th is the 15th day of the 12th month. March 20th is the 16th day of the 12th month on the biblical calendar. I don't see any particular symbols in the Mayan particularly. So we have that date, and then we have the end date. So the end date being November 15th, 2011. It's the 19th of Heshvan. Yeah, Iran. You saying something? Somebody said something?
Okay, I hadn't said anything, but I have a question.
Ahead.
Since you're looking at that date, 20th of March of 2003,
Yeah.
don't you wind up with a symbol of the Levites on the Julian date?
March 6th.
No, take no, if you're using March 20th.
Okay, I see. So March 7th, like
So,
all together, you've got a 3-2-7, like the two dates.
like a 273.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that could be something. I've never done, put the Julian and the Gregorian dates together to get a symbol like that.
Okay.
But okay. So that's when we got this war beginning. I'm not sure why the two different dates, why March 19th and March 20th. I think it just has to do with the action, basically of first declaring war or whatever, and then the actually starting the war. I don't know, because the troops go in on March 20th. There's some kind of attack anyway on March 20th, but so maybe they're marking from the attack. So I mean, I can take some of these numbers like this, 8480 number, and I count from that. I get to June 6, 2026, right? So when I try to count numbers that I have in here, I haven't found any that I haven't looked at them all, just looked at a few, to count from this to our history, right? So that's why I put in, well, we got this, but we could also put in stuff dealing with Trump as well. I don't know, but I was trying to look more as the connection between George Bush and Obama. Now, we know that Obama's going to be around for 8 years as well. So, if I add, oh, here we go. Oops, I had to go back here. So this is going to be Trump's inauguration. Right, in 2017. And so if we look at some of these dates, this is kind of interesting that 5056 that we had between the two 2688s. So this is unrelated, but you get that 5056 between the end or the beginning of this war, if we mark it as March 19th. 2003 to Trump's inauguration is 5056. So that same number we were just talking about. So that other number, 5056, that was the number of days between Obama's inauguration, what was it? No, the yeah, so Obama's inauguration and November 24th, 2022. Right. So if I went here, 5056. Right. So that's going to give me that date. And then from here, I count this 2688. And that's going to give me, that's an exclusive count. There we go there. It's actually at the end of November 24th, not the beginning. But anyway, so we have that same sort of symbol, right? That same symbol, the 5056 here and the 5056 here. So that means that there is, what does that mean? That we get this number showing up twice in these. In these dates that we are looking at. So what we're doing is we're connecting then these 2688s, right? So I mean it should kind of be obvious that we're going to have the those two there, but I wasn't really thinking about it until we just looked at this. So that means we have these 2688s. So now we have this other 5056 dealing with the beginning of the war in Iraq. So what would we do with that? I know I'm just going to go back to 2688, see what I get. Probably nothing. November 8th, 1995. I don't know if that's significant or anything. Probably not. And then if I count from this, then I would count 2688, May 31st, 2024. So that's going to be 2,688 days since the end of the Iraq War, right? Whether that means anything. Okay, so just taking another structure, seeing if it fits in. But we do have the 5056. So remember, 5056 is this horn, and it's related to the pushing that we see in Daniel chapter 11, verse 40, right? At the time of the end, the king of the south shall push at the king of the north, right? That's how we understand that. That's going to be 5055, but it's related. They're related words, 5055, 5056. Okay, so we have this pushing. So how do we understand this then in connection with what we're seeing here? Is it significant? Is it just, does it mean anything? We have the number twice, the 5056. So, I mean, one thing we could say is that these are horns, because what is it that we're saying about the presidents of the United States? Obviously, they're going to be kings, they're going to be. How are we understanding these powers, these presidents? Why are we even looking at the presidents of the United States in connection with these emperors? Julius Caesar, not an emperor as such, but at least a dictator from Rome.
We're connecting the 10 kings in Revelation 17 to 10 horns.
Okay, so in Revelation 17, we have 10 horns. Now, horns represent the United Nations in that context, right? The 10 kings in Revelation chapter 17. We have a beast with 7 heads and 10 horns. We actually have two beasts or three beasts even in Revelation. And in Revelation 17, so just go back and review what we understood about this. So we're going to have this this beast that's being ridden by the mother of harlots, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, the abominations of the earth. This is the papacy riding these kingdoms of this world. This is at the end of time, right? This is the third incarnation of Rome. We have ancient Rome, we could call it pagan Rome. And then we have papal Rome, right? Revelation 13, the beast with 7 heads and 10 horns, the composite beast, which is the papacy. And now we have this woman writing this piece. And then we're going to have this explanation. And in this explanation, they're going to refer back to the beast of Revelation 13. The beast that thou sawest that was and is not, and shall ascend into a bottomless pit. That's the beast of Revelation 13, right? So the angel is explaining to John the connection between this beast that he's seen and the beast that he saw in chapter 13. Right? And then we know that we have these seven heads and ten horns, and the kings with the ten horns, they don't have a kingdom as yet, right? And so we try to deal with this whole time. And we have come to the conclusion that the time in which we are in is the time in which five have fallen and one is. And we determined that these kings are presidents. So they're not the horns. These are the heads, right? But horns and heads have some similarities to them. And so we can look at, when we look at the heads in, you know, chapter 13, they're going to be these successive kingdoms, Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, pagan, Rome, papal, the United States, and the United Nations, right? When we're looking at these seven heads here, well, these seven heads are seven mountains upon which the woman sitteth, right? So we can say that this is Rome, the city of Rome, right? So we haven't intentionally done this. We haven't tried to combine lots of different views together. We just saw that people who had sort of this one view that the heads are always the same thing and the horns are always the same thing and the beasts are always basically the same thing doesn't really make sense, right? That the beasts at these different periods of time, they have some of the same characteristics, but they have characteristics that differ, right? So we have said that these seven kings in Revelation 17, verse 10, are, in its primary application, presidents of the United States, right? That it's not referring to the seven heads, right? That the seven heads, or seven mountains on which the woman sitteth, in verse 9, is referring to the city of Rome. But the seven kings is not referring to the city of Rome. It's not referring to the seven heads. That is, the seven kings are not the seven heads. These are presidents of the United States. Okay? So this is kind of a unique view, right? In how we came about this. And we did it, you know, very methodically. And we're not, you know, adamant about this, but this to us makes the most sense. So five are fallen. That's going to be George Bush the first, then Clinton, then George Bush the second, then Obama, then Trump. The one that is Biden, right? And then there's going to be a seventh, right? He's not yet come, so that's still future. And when he comes, he continues a short space. I'm not sure what that means. But then there is going to be the eighth. And he's of the seven. It doesn't say he's one of the seven. The beast that was in not, he is the eighth. That is, in that union of the United States and the ten horns, the ten kings, right? That's the United Nations and the papacy. That's where we see the eighth. That is, the United States has this eighth head, this president, but it's really the papacy, right? That's the way we understand it. We could be wrong, but that's how what made the most sense, taking all of the information that we had. Okay, so we can see that horns can represent kings. In this case, it's going to represent the ten horns are going to represent the United Nations in this context. But we have other examples. We have Daniel chapter 8, right? We're going to have horns as well. Now, horns, you're going to have a ram with two horns. Well, that's the kingdoms of Media and Persia, right? And then you're going to have a goat with a single horn, right? And that horn is going to break off and there's going to be four horns come up, right? And then there's going to come up another horn, which is called the little horn, right? In Daniel chapter 8. Which is going to be pagan and papal Rome. in its different phases, right? And it's going to alternate masculine and feminine back and forth, right? There's all of these things. So we know that if we're looking at Daniel chapter 11, and we're trying to understand this history in Daniel chapter 11, that we have these in our presidents. So we're saying that these are the presidents of the United States, that we have three of them marked here, right? We have Bush the second, Obama, and then Trump, right? That's going to be, you know, Julius Caesar, right? Augustus, and then Tiberius, right? So the vile person is Tiberius, and that's Trump. And we're saying that we have some spans of time in our history that relate to this symbol of pushing with a horn. And so that's kind of tenuous. We don't have here in these verses that word, but we do have it in Daniel 11, verse 40. And so the question that we're asking then, is this significant? Does this idea of pushing, because what you have is kingdom standing up, or kings in this case, presidents standing up, right? So first you're going to have, if you go back to Daniel 11, verse 16, and it says, he shall stand in the glorious land, which by his hand shall be consumed. Who is this he that stands in the glorious land? Daniel 11, verse 16.
In the past, we've always looked at that as being the papacy.
Right. So it's the papacy, right? That's who it's going to be. So we have the papacy that's going to stand in the glorious land. And this is going to be in that history connected to the fall of the Soviet Union, right? And that's going to be in this history under George Bush the first, with his New World Order speech on September 11th, 1990 at the joint session, right? So we see that there's this connection there in that history. So the United States has the papacy stand in it. We're also going to have the Pope, who's going to meet. What's the date that the Pope meets? I'm trying to remember that. Here, I got to find it.
With George Bush the first or the second?
The first. So you're going to have the Pope. Let me see here. Okay, it's the new in the list of New World Order speeches. Okay, so you have the joint session of Congress, September 11th, 1990. So I have the speech there. There's the announcement on January 16th, 1991 of the Persian Gulf things. So this is George Bush Sr., right? And then you're going to have, I thought there was one dealing with the Pope, the New World Order speech having to do, or maybe it's just the Pope meets. Does the, okay. So when does the Pope, does he go to a joint session of Congress? Is that under George Bush the second? So that would be another.
Okay. The George Bush Sr.
Okay.
Only met the popes in the Vatican.
Okay.
So the Pope did not come to America at that point. He okay. came. The Pope came to America when Reagan was president. He came to America when Carter was president. But the majority of the time, the presidents would go to the Vatican. Now, Bush the second met the Pope at Castle Gandolfo, and twice in 2002 and 2004 in Vatican City.
Yeah. So has the Pope ever spoken? Didn't he recently, one of the popes spoke to the American Congress or something?
Looking. I know that a future pope spoke before the U.S. Congress.
Oh, yeah.
In 1965, Paul VI spoke before the United Nations.
Okay, so Pope Francis, he's going to come to the United States in 2015. He goes to Washington, D.C. He went to visit the United Nations as well.
October 6, 1979 was the first visit by a pope to the White House.
Okay.
And that was under Jimmy Carter.
Okay, so September 24th, 2015, Pope Francis became the first pope to address a joint session of the United States Congress at
Okay.
the invitation of House Speaker John Boehner and Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, both Catholics. Okay, so September 24th, 2015. Now that date, of course, is September 11th on the Julian calendar, but
Okay.
because it's 13 days different.
Now, on June 4th of 2004, Bush the second, Bush Jr., presented John Paul the second with the Presidential Medal of Freedom.
Yeah, I'm just looking at this date dealing with the joint session of Congress. So I just put in that date dealing with September, the other joint session of Congress, the New World Order speech, and then going to September 24th, 2015. So obviously that's a period of 25 years and 13 days, 9,144 days, which is 127 times 72. I don't know if that means anything. So we have some interesting things here, though, dealing with these, with this history. So again, some of these chronological things that take a lot of time to sort of piece together, but and we're going to draw these things out on a line. Once we start drawing these things out on a line, I think we'll see a lot more detail that we can pay attention to. So going back here to this, we know that we've connected the events prior to the time of the end, that is, Rome exalting itself to establish the vision, and then the events connected to the time of the end with 9/11. And then the events of 9/11, where you're going to have George Bush Jr., Bush the second, and then we're going to have these successive presidents, right? So Bush, Obama, Trump. We're saying that these verses are addressing that. That's the assumption that we started with. We started with that information going back to 2016 when this was first looked into by Jeff, that he's going to start looking at this connection between these verses in Daniel 11 and the presidents. Remember, Trump isn't the president yet when Jeff is looking at this, right? So in 2016, this is before the election, and Jeff is going to be saying, well, we have Bush the second, he's going to be Julius Caesar, Obama is Augustus, and then Trump is going to be Tiberius Caesar, right? That's how it was understood. Now remember, we also had other parallels with the Persian kings, right? So this was just another parallel, looking at these presidents, not all of them, but three of them here, looking at them and comparing them with these, the dictator of Julius Caesar and the two emperors, Augustus and Tiberius. So we still have some questions to answer. So one is, in Bush the second, do we have a parallel that can be compared to Caesar's assassination? And I don't think that we have, definitely not in the literal sense, but he's going to be pushed at, we're going to say, by Obama, right? Now, of course, Bush the second runs his 2 terms, right? So, I mean, personally, he himself couldn't be reelected again. So, I mean, he's going to have to, I mean, his, I mean, a Republican could have run again against Obama, but didn't. I mean, didn't win, right? So we had a Republican running against him, but they didn't win. So you could have had, the Republicans, they could have had successive administrations, but they didn't, right? So you're going to have the Republicans and then the Democrats. Okay. Now we're not dealing here with, battles between the king of the north and the king of the south. We're having something that's happening within Rome itself, right? Now there is a civil war earlier, right? And so Julius Caesar is, when he says here, going back, he set his face to enter with all the strength, the whole kingdom, and the upright ones with him. We have this is George Bush the second. Like that's what we're saying. This is Julius Caesar. And this is going to be connected with him conquering Egypt. You're going to Cleopatra introduced in here, and we're saying that it's God that gives Julius Caesar the daughter of women, corrupting her, causing her ruin. And we're saying that it's in God's providence that we have George Bush the second. He's given this the world, the UN, the dragon power, and this is going to lead to the fall of the world, right? But the UN is not going to stand, right? So even though that this power, Egypt, the UN, it doesn't stand, right? It's going to be conquered. Okay. So then we have this occupation of Egypt, the conquering of atheistic communism. But he, Bush the second, will turn his face unto the isles. Now, in the case of Caesar here, it's Julius Caesar. That's the Mediterranean basin, peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongue, the UN. So we're saying that he was given the UN, but he's going to try to do something with the UN. And we're saying, well, there is in this war in Iraq that the America is going to operate against the UN. So it's going to operate illegally in this war in Iraq, as far as the world government is concerned. And then we have this introduction of Christ, of the 144,000, Michael, your prince, the July 18, 2020 symbol. And so a cross is introduced here in this history. And Christ takes that reproach upon himself. So there's still things having to do with this movement. In a sense, the movement experiences the cross in that disappointment, right? So it's, so the reference to the cross, Christ takes our shame upon himself, that this is a reference to the disappointment, right? So what we were expecting to be a type of the Sunday law. And then we have Julius Caesar, Bush the second, right? He now turns his face toward the fort of his own land. So first he went to the Isles, right? And we're saying that now it's internal problems that he's going to address, but he shall stumble and fall and not be found. Now, obviously, with Bush the second, is there any way that we can understand this stumble and fall in some other way in an application in our time, and this not being found? Now, what happens near the end of Bush the second's presidency? Everybody should remember this. What's going to happen around the time of the election in 2008?
We have an economic collapse.
Okay, yeah. So there's a financial collapse. Now, what was the cause of that?
Banksters.
What did you say?
Banksters. The
Oh,
banks.
banks. Okay. Okay. Well, it's about the housing market, right? Primarily, it has to do with these loans. Right, that's primarily what starts it. I don't know how many people here follow all the economic stuff. So they were giving people were the pr house prices were skyrocketing based upon cheap credit and lax lending standards. Right, so they sometimes call it the housing bubble. So when the bubble burst, the banks were left holding the bag, so to speak. That, right. So they had all of this debt they didn't really want to be having. So there's going to be this financial crisis. So is there any way that we can connect this with Bush the second stumbling and falling and not being found?
That would be an interesting application, considering that economic collapse that was happening. was because of third parties and not directly because of Bush.
Yeah. Now, the thing is, he's turning his face toward the fort of his own land, right? I mean, so a fort, I mean, is a type of building, but I don't know if that has anything to do with the housing crisis.
Could you try to make the application that the fort was the economic engine of the United States?
Okay, yeah, you could. So the idea of a fort is a fortified place. It's defense, it's strength. And of course, that's the strength of the United States is its military power, right? Now, the idea of stumbling, right? You know, to stumble, stagger, totter. I mean, when you talk about an economic collapse, it's kind of like that, right? The thing builds up, right? You get this housing bubble, and then it just collapses. And of course, the word fall, I mean, the stock market fell, right?
The stock market greatly stumbled, yes.
Yeah, stumbled and fell.
Okay, but here's the other thing that I'm finding to be kind of interesting.
Okay.
You have three times that popes have visited Washington, D.C. to visit with the president.
Okay.
Only once did a president go to Andrews Air Force Base to meet the Pope. And that was by Bush the Second.
Okay.
The other popes that met at the White House, the president waited for them to arrive.
Okay, so the significance of that?
Well, Bush the Second was giving greater honor to the Pope because instead of waiting for the Pope to come to him, he went to the Pope and met the Pope most directly.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Now,
In many situations, if you look back through history, did the popes usually go to a reigning king, or did the kings come to the Pope?
Well, the kings came to the Pope.
That's the point.
Okay. Well, getting back to this stumble following and falling and not being found. So the idea of found, it can mean to secure or acquire or to get. That's actually its primary thing, to find something, to secure it. So it's not just, you know, finding something in the sense of, you know, something's lost and you find it. It's actually about securing something or acquiring something. So we could say that this inward focus that's happening under George Bush the Second's presidency, at the end of his presidency, is really this issue of the economy, right? So this stumbling and falling and not being found would refer to the economic collapse. And then in verse 20, then shall stand up in his estate a raiser of taxes in the glory of the kingdom, but within a few days he shall be destroyed neither in anger nor in battle. So we'd have to figure out, you know, sure, it's fine to say Obama had a lot of taxes, right? I mean, don't all presidents raise taxes?
No.
They don't? Well, obviously, that was more rhetorical. Most presidents do. I mean, obviously, you had people like Reagan and others who didn't. Trump didn't. But, you know, to just kind of single out Obama, is he worse than George Bush the Second? I don't know much about what particular taxes. I do know he brought in a really poor Medicare type of thing that made no sense.
Well, okay, the Medicare kind of thing, which many here still call Obamacare,
Obamacare.
was, I mean, it's a fallacy. All it is just another method of government control. Biden has very much followed in the path of Obama, because instead of looking to expand anything having to do with independent business, he has done everything possible to expand government control.
Right. And the secret to good health care is actually a free market.
Right.
Which, I mean, the thing is, you know, we have public health in Canada, but we don't spend near the kind of money that Americans spend on their health care. And I mean, I kind of like free health care, you know, because you can have a health issue. If you don't have coverage, I mean, it could maybe not, you could end up in poverty, right? So, but anyway, that's this whole other issue. The point is, what they did in America made no sense, as because you just have this huge bureaucracy of insurance companies and government running healthcare, and most of your cost has nothing to actually do with healthcare. And that's always a problem. In a true free market, you would have cheaper healthcare because there'd be less administration. But it's one of those politicized issues. So I don't want to really go into that one too much. But the idea then we can say, okay, you know, George Bush the second, let me see here. So he turns his face, right? So he's going to turn his face toward the affordable, his own land. He stumbles and falls and it's not found. This has to do with the economic collapse in the United States. Now, in some ways, we can say the presidents represent the country at that time. So this is not just about George Bush II personally. It's about the United States at that time, right? So the next president, Obama, is going to be a raiser of taxes. But within a few days, he shall be destroyed neither in anger nor in battle, right? So, you know, the question is, how would we apply these things, right? So we know Augustus just dies peacefully and, you know, it's not going to have somebody assassinate him. It's not going to be during a war. And the word destroyed, though, is kind of an odd one in that sense, right? That is, it means to break down, off in pieces, be broken, crushed, hurt. Right. So it has some things. It literally means to burst. So, you know, destroyed is kind of a strong word there. You know, he's going to break down within a few days. And why a few days? What does that refer to? And a few days is 259. Few is that one. And then 3117 is days. So you got 3,376 as a number. If we type in the few days as we take it as a span of time, that's going to end up being 9 years and about 89 days. 9 years and 89 days as a symbol. I don't know what that means. 88.75 days, if you want to be more exact. So depending where you start in the leap year, it's going to be 9 years. Three out of four times, it'll be 9 years and 89 days. One time out of four, it'll be 9 years and 88 days. So it depends where you start. So we could take that span of time and try to find where it would fit. Now, 9 years, of course, is going to be 1 year longer than two terms. And then you got another 88 days. So I don't know where you would fit something like that in, right? So 3,376 days. If you count from 9/11, it brings you to April 19th, 2010. If you count from the start of the Iraq War, it's just going to bring you somewhere in 2012. So let me see. June 15th, 2012, so beginning of the Iraq War. if you go from when Obama became president and is inaugurated on January 20th, 2009. Again, it's going to bring you April 19th this time, 2018, because you're counting from an inauguration day. It's 2000 April 19th, which April 19th, if we did it in inclusive counts, it would be April 18th, which would be the first day of the first month in 2018. Now, 2018, that's when we're going to end up with all this time setting in the movement. We go to the end of the Iraq War, just November 15th, 2011, and we count 3376. We're going to come to Stephen's birthday in 2021, February 11th, right? So those are the things, you know, just a cursory look at that number, 9 years and 88 days. Brings us to some symbols, April 19th, right? So if you count from an inauguration date, it's going to bring you to an April 19th date. So maybe there's something there with that, those numbers. So, but the thing is, it says the verse itself has to do with these, but within a few days. Now, within, I wonder why they put within there. So I'm just going to see, there's probably a bet attached to the beginning of the word. No, that's kind of weird. That makes no sense. Now, the reason why they translate it as few, it's actually the word ichad. Ichad, it just means one. It's the number one. But it's in plural, right? Ichadim, right? So, so it's a plural of the number one. So it's literally one's days, right? So I guess that would be the Hebrew idiom to express a few. So days of ones, literally. Because days is first. And it has a bet in front of the word days. So within days of ones. So if we wanted to be even more specific, because the bet is the one that means in, right? In days of once. Kind of interesting. So within a few days, in days of ones, he shall be destroyed neither in anger nor in battle. So how would we apply this to Obama? I mean, we could take that number and we look at, you know, 3376 and try to do something with it. Any thoughts about days of, in days of ones? It's very strange sometimes when you translate Hebrew literally. And they put but here, right? So again, in Hebrew, they don't really have a word like that. It just have a vav, which means and. And in days of ones, he shall be destroyed. So a few days is how they're translating that idiom. But is there any way that we can take that symbol and apply it? Can we apply it in some ways to that election? How would the election of Trump, how would that, how could we apply this in a few days he shall be destroyed? So how does it, what ends up happening now? Trump is not going to be running against Obama, right? He's going to be running against Hillary.
Correct.
So is there any way that we would take, you know, because both Bush the second and Obama run two terms. So is there any way that we can tie this into that history? I mean, so far, a lot of these ties in, they're fairly tenuous. I mean, there's not like a real clear cut. You know, here's exactly what this would mean. Right. So he's going to, you know, die a peaceful death. Obama does. Right, or Augustus does, but we're going to say Obama does. And yet we're going to have to somehow tie this in with the end of Obama's presidency in some way. Now, when we look at some of these words, like neither in anger nor in battle, right? So 639 is just the word refers to the nostril or nose or face, right? So it becomes like a... an illustration of anger is just a reference to the nose. because the person is breathing rapidly, right? So that's the idea of not in anger. And again, the same word, nor, right? Neither in nor, both the same word in Hebrew, in battle, right? So battle, war, that's just the typical word for battle. It's just the idea of a fight. It means literally to feed on or to consume. By implication of battle is destruction. So that's not going to happen. He's not going to be destroyed. He's not going to, remember, destroyed his burst. It's not going to be in anger nor in battle. Okay, so I don't know how we would address this. So this is Augustus, right? This is Obama, supposedly, if that's the case. And then we have in his estate, shall stand up a vile person. Now notice sometimes we'll have words like in, and they actually don't have a separate word. They're just going to have, you know, a bet attached to them. But this word in here, you know, is a preposition. That's often a prefix, right? And it's just the word al. So in his estate, this is a stronger idea that is in the place of something. So in the place of this, in his estate, shall stand up a vile person. So we know that we've understood this to be Trump. So at the end of Obama's reign, he's not going to run again because he can't. And we're going to have, you know, Hillary Clinton. She's not mentioned here, right? Is there any way that we can understand this? I mean, we can see why, you know, Jeff would say we're going to have this to be, you know, Bush the second, Obama and Trump. But there still is a lot of things that don't have an explanation, right? They don't. We would have to understand how this is applied with these successive presidents and how they're paralleling Julius Caesar, Augustus Caesar, and Tiberius Caesar. Any thoughts on this?
Yeah, it's not easy. There's nothing really obvious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I would say. Nothing really obvious. So would we just say that this doesn't make sense? That this application that Jeff had made back in 2016 doesn't really fit? Or is there something that we're missing? Okay, so one of the things that we have to look at here is these emperors, we're just going to include Julius Caesar. He's of course, a dictator. They wanted to declare him a tyrant, but they never got around to legally do so. And he wanted to be a king, so he wanted to be an emperor. But it's not going to be till Augustus we get the first emperor. So the question really has to do with, why is this here in the Bible? Right? So we know that it's going to be in the time of Rome that we're going to see, in this time of Rome. We're going to have, of course, in Augustus, Christ is going to be born. In Tiberius, Christ is going to be crucified, right? And we have Julius Caesar here because this is going to be connected with Rome in this history, with Rome being in the Holy Land, right? So there's a lot involved here with these previous, with the fall of Greece and then the rise of Rome. Rome exalts itself to establish the vision, and then it's going to stand in the glorious land. Right? So Rome becomes the king of the north. And so maybe there's something that we're missing in understanding the context of what this is talking about. That is, I'm not saying that we need to get rid of the idea that Julius Caesar is here, or that, you know, or not Julius Caesar, Bush the second is Julius Caesar, or Obama as Augustus, or Trump as Tiberius. but that there's something else more happening here, that there's some reference to what this, when they stand up, what it is they're standing up to do. It's not just that they're being presidents of the United States, but they have a certain role in events that are connected to this movement, to Seventh-day Adventism, to the rise of this message, right? And we have all of these symbols, right? We've got the symbol of the Sunday law. When we get to verse 22, and with the arms of a flood, shall they be overflown from before him, and shall be broken, and shall be broken, yea, also the Prince of the Covenant, right? So here we have the symbol of the Sunday law, the symbol of the cross, and we need to tie this in together. So that was, we have this history from 9/11 to July 18, 2020, or maybe even to December 25th, 2021, in some ways, that we really have to address that, because I think that there is something here. I don't think that we would just abandon all of this, but I do think that we're maybe looking at it in the wrong way, or not wrong, but just not, there's some key that we're missing, right? And then the next thing we're going to come to, verse 23. So we have said all of this comes up to this typical line of the Sunday law, right? It's not going to go to the Sunday law, the actual Sunday law. And then in verse 23, we're going to go back and rehearse this history going back to this league and starting in 161 to 158 BC, right? So I really want people to give this a lot of thought, you know, today, if you can, you know, for Stephen, it would be tomorrow. And try to understand what's happening here, why we're running into this wall. Now, we could be running into the wall because we're going in the wrong direction. We've done that before. But if we're going in the wrong direction, we need God to help us here, and we need him always. But we need to understand what is happening here. Okay. And any final thoughts before we close with prayer? Okay. Well, let's pray. Now, dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the time here this morning, for this study. And we pray for enlightenment. We know as we look at this history, as we look at the history within the United States in this period of time that we're creating this parallel, that there's difficulties that we have. And so we need to be corrected wherever we are in error. And we need your light to shine upon our feet, upon the path before us, that we can walk in that light. We pray for each person searching for truth. And we pray for light wherever it comes from to guide us, as long as it comes from you ultimately. And so we pray for each person. May your angels watch over us, our family and loved ones. And may your Holy Spirit go before us in all that we come in contact with. May we be able to share of your love. And we pray this and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.